army. They were out to plunder. There were others who had resentments that went on after the war, and there was violence that that took place for quite some time after the Civil War because of the bitterness engendered during that time. After the Civil War, of course, East Tennessee, having supported the Union, found themselves kind of at odds with our neighbors in Middle and West Tennessee, and Melungeon became sort of an epithet for all people from East Tennessee. And I will talk about that a little bit later, how the term Melungeon was used in a political sense as well as an ethnic sense. In the late 19th century, an author, a newspaper writer from Nashville named Will Allen Dromgoole, despite the name, Will Allen was a female. She wrote about the Melungeons in terms that were not exactly complimentary, and this kind of coincided with the rise of the Jim Crow laws in the South in the post-Reconstruction era. And I think Will Allen Dromgoole, as offensive as many of us find her articles, actually reflected the general attitude that most Americans had toward people of color, and particularly those of a mixed ethnic background. That sort of prejudice continued into the 20th century. In Virginia, in particular, the 1924 Racial Integrity Act pretty much eliminated all categories of people except for two. There was white and there was colored. There were, as far as the state of Virginia was concerned, there were no Indians, there were no people with mixed ethnic background. You were white or you were not, and they were pretty strict about who they allowed to be considered white. One of the interesting things, though, is that, of course, many Virginians proudly proclaim their ancestry from Pocahontas, and these are people who, in many cases, were the aristocrats of Virginia. So the Racial Integrity Act had what some people called the Pocahontas Clause, which allowed a certain percentage, which would have been about the exact percentage of someone who was descended from Pocahontas. They got to be considered white. If you were descended from Pocahontas' brother or cousin, you were out of luck. But the people who were descended from Pocahontas sort of had a little exemption in that law. And that had a big impact on people of mixed ethnic ancestry, particularly the Melungeons. The law required county clerks to designate these people who had in many cases had been considered white. They were designated as colored. They were expected to prevent marriages between Melungeons and whites, and of course the entire Indian population of Virginia disappeared, at least on paper, because of this law. There were suddenly no Indians in Virginia anymore. You won't find the Indians listed on census records during that time. Now, the situation for Melungeons in Tennessee was a little bit more ambiguous. There weren't specific laws regarding Melungeons. It was more a matter of custom. And in Hancock County in particular, Melungeons were not permitted to go to public schools. And even had they been permitted to go to public schools, many of the Melungeons lived on the north side of Newman's Ridge. If any of you have ever been to Hancock County, you're probably familiar with Newman's Ridge. There was not a good road going across Newman's Ridge until the 1950s. So even if the families on the north side of the ridge had been permitted to go to the public schools, they really had no way to get there. So in the early part of the 20th century, the Presbyterians were active in setting up missions in Appalachia and in other places, and they set up a mission in Vardy Valley, also known as Blackwater Valley in Hancock County. Later today, Katie Vanderbreak will be talking about the Vardy mission. Just to go over it kind of briefly, they established a church and a school in about 1899, and provided educational opportunities that were really remarkable for their time. These were highly educated people who staffed these missions, and they set up a small schoolhouse at first, and then in 1929 they built a modern school, a three-story building that was really very progressive for its time. They had various programs that some schools don't even have today. They had individualized curriculum for each student. They weren't so concerned with textbooks. They were trying to bring the Melungeons into a state of literacy to allow them to really join modern society. They offered vocational education, adult education. There were health clinics, and also they brought in people from other Presbyterian institutions such as Berea College and Warren Wilson College. During the time that the Presbyterians were operating in Hancock County, they did not use the term Melungeon. Of course, as I said, it was considered a pejorative term, and I think you'll find Katie Vandenbroek's take on that is very interesting, because these missionaries obviously were aware of the unique ethnic status of the Melungeons, but they made a point of not bringing it up or referring to it in any way. Many of the people from Vardy and from Hancock County moved away, as did many people in Appalachia. They moved away for economic reasons. My family moved away for that same reason, to go up north and build automobiles for General Motors, which is not exactly a great career move today, but at that time it was an opportunity, and as I was growing up, I think I had about as many Melungeon kinfolk in Michigan, Ohio, and Indiana as I did here in Tennessee. Many of the people who attended the Vardy School moved away for better economic opportunities. Many stayed behind and stayed in Hancock County, stayed in this area, and became leaders of the community. And in the mid-1960s, Hancock County was looking for ways to improve their economic situation. Hancock County was and still is one of the poorer counties in the United States. And working with the University of Tennessee, the civic leaders of Hancock County were looking at ways of generating income for the county. And at that time, one of the things that was talked about was doing an outdoor drama. And outdoor dramas were quite popular in the 1960s. There are still several of them in operation today, but in the 60s there were many more of them. The idea of doing a drama about the Melungeons probably would have been unthinkable prior to 1965, because everything that had been written about the Melungeons was derogatory. Even if it was unintentional, it was condescending. I think Will Allen Drumgoole referred to the Melungeons as a blight on our state. There weren't too many people who were eager to identify themselves with that group until Jesse Stewart wrote the novel called Daughter of the Legend. This book was written in the 1940s, but not published until 1965. The story goes that when Jesse Stewart was a student at Lincoln Memorial University, he fell in love with a Melungeon girl from Hancock County, but his parents disapproved, and I guess they were the ones paying for his tuition. They put a stop to that relationship, but he wrote a novel about the Melungeons, and although it seems a bit dated today, it was really the first nice thing anybody ever wrote about us. And that was really when I asked my aunt, when I first learned about our Melungeon heritage, I said, well, you know, what does this mean? And she handed me a copy of Jesse Stewart's book and said, this is who we are. Well, it was a fictional book, but